Okay, we are recording. So again, my name is Kurt Munzer. I'm one of the pulmonary doctors at Mercy South. And I thank Danny for inviting me tonight. And I thank everyone here for joining. I don't think the presentation should take too terribly long. And I invite all questions since we are recording. If you can either type them in the message board or, you know, save them for the end, that would be great. So firstly, I don't have any financial relationships or disclosures. I'm not being paid by either Amgen or Bristol-Myers Squibb. These slides were previously reviewed by Dr. David Carbone and then by me last week. And then, as already mentioned, this program was developed by the cancer support community. And let's start. So, as a brief overview, first we're going to talk about what is lung cancer, the epidemiology, how prevalent is it, how many people get lung cancer each year. Then we'll talk about the different subtypes of lung cancer, specifically small cell lung cancer and non-small cell lung cancer. We will delve into, you know, partnering with your healthcare team. Certainly once you have a diagnosis of lung cancer, you meet a lot of new doctors, a lot of new nurses, physical therapists, palliative care folks. So life changes pretty dramatically. And then we'll talk about how to manage the side effects, both from the cancer and the chemotherapy and the treatments we often give to treat the cancer, before finishing up with living with lung cancer, which I think Danny's going to deliver that, and then a Q&A at the end. So firstly, what is lung cancer? So lung cancer is the second most common cancer in men and women. The most common in women is breast cancer, and the most common in men is prostate cancer. Although it is the second most common, it is the deadliest cancer in both men and women. Since the early 1980s, lung cancer mortality has eclipsed breast cancer mortality, and lung cancer kills about 1.6 million people throughout the world each year. In the United States, about 230 people are diagnosed with lung cancer each year, and about 150,000 of those die of lung cancer each year. So certainly it is a big deal. And the more we can do to educate folks about the signs and symptoms and treatments of lung cancer can only be beneficial. Like I mentioned, there's two main types of lung cancer. You have non-small cell lung cancer and small cell lung cancer. We'll go into that a little bit more later. Of note, we're not talking about cancers from other organs that spread to their lungs. So certainly some people can have colon cancer or breast cancer or prostate cancer that spreads or metastasizes to the lungs, but that's a different beast in itself. So something I'm very passionate about is on this next slide, lung cancer screening. So all major medical organizations have recommended lung cancer screening since about 2013, after the publication of the lung cancer screening trial. Everyone knows about mammography for breast cancer screening and colonoscopy for colon cancer screening, but lung cancer screening is new. And what this is it's a yearly low-dose radiation CT scan to look for small pulmonary nodules in the lungs. And the reason we do this is because overall, our lung doesn't have that many nerves. The covering of the lung has a lot of nerves, as well as some of the structures in the center of the chest. But you can develop a pretty large lung cancer without any symptoms. And most people don't develop symptoms until it's a very large tumor or until it spreads to other organs. So what lung cancer screening is meant to do, it's meant to find the cancer when it's very small, so we could either cut it out or shoot radiation at the cancer and potentially cure the patient. Lung cancer screening is recommended for patients between the ages of 50 and 80, although as a caveat, CMS or the Centers for Medicaid and Medicare only pay for lung cancer screening or cover lung cancer screening until the age of 77. So from a Medicare standpoint, they'll pay for it from the ages of 50 to 77. People that are eligible or between that age, and they either currently smoke or they've smoked cigarettes within the last 15 years, and they've had to be at least a moderate smoker. So you have to have at least a 20-pack year tobacco use history. And that means one pack a day for 20 years, or a half pack a day for 40 years, or two packs a day for 10 years, et cetera. So non-small cell lung cancer is the most prevalent type of lung cancer, and it's actually split up into three different subtypes: adenocarcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, and large cell carcinoma. Adenocarcinoma is the most prevalent subtype, and it's typically one of the lung cancers that kind of grows in the periphery of the lungs. And what that means is most patients don't have any symptoms of adenocarcinoma for months or even years until it grows or becomes big enough that patients do have symptoms. We'll talk about the treatments for the different non-small cell lung cancers in a later slide. The other subtype of lung cancer is small cell lung cancer. I think that's on the next slide. Danny, can you advance the...
Yeah, sorry about that.
No, it's okay. Small cell lung cancer is less common. Only about 10 to 15% of lung cancers are small cell lung cancer. It's also known as Ott cell lung cancer. And it's a little bit different than non-small cell lung cancers. It typically spreads much more quickly, spreads throughout the lung or spreads to lymph nodes or spreads to other organs. And because of that, the treatment modalities for small cell lung cancer do differ. Before we move on to the next slide, I do want to make a point that when we hear about lung cancer, we always think about people who smoke cigarettes. And that's because certainly that's the number one risk factor for lung cancer, but you do not have to smoke to get lung cancer. There are many other causes, or at least occupational and avocational activities that can increase your risk of lung cancer. So even though we always focus on smokers, even non-smokers, although it's uncommon, can develop lung cancer. All right, so before we start talking about partnering with your healthcare team, I do want to briefly discuss diagnosis. And that's because for patients that are kind of early on in this process, it can be very confusing. So when we have a nodule in the lungs, or if we have an enlarged lymph node in the chest, your doctor, whether it's the oncologist or the pulmonary doctor, our goal is to not only diagnose the cancer, but try to find out what stage it is. As lung cancers grow bigger, or if they spread throughout the chest, or if they spread throughout other organs, they become more advanced stage. So our goal is to try to find the procedure to diagnose and stage the cancer as safely and efficiently as possible. This could be done with a percutaneous biopsy, and that's where an interventional radiologist will numb up the skin. And then using a CT scan, they'll stick a small needle through the skin and into the lungs and sample the nodule. Certainly if the nodule's in one of your major airways, or if it is spread to the lymph nodes, that's when I come into play, and I can do a procedure known as a bronchoscopy, where we sedate the patient and we go in through the mouth into the lungs, and we can sample or biopsy the cancer in that matter. So once you have a diagnosis of lung cancer, this is where things change very drastically. You meet a lot of doctors in a short amount of time. That would include a medical oncologist. These are the doctors that talk about treatments, whether it's chemotherapy or immunotherapy or targeted therapy. They also manage a lot of the complications of both the treatments and of the cancer. You might meet with a thoracic surgeon. That is a specialized surgeon that primarily deals with diseases in the chest. So if we're talking about a surgery to remove the lung cancer, you'll be working closely with a thoracic surgeon. And then we have radiation oncologists too. These are doctors that primarily use radiation to try to treat the lung cancer. And some patients may only need radiation. They may need a combination of radiation and chemotherapy. Can we move on to the next slide? Other people you meet would be nurses. This could be the nurses in the clinic. This could be the nurses when you're getting chemotherapy or with the radiation oncologist. This could be a nurse practitioner working with the physician. This could be a nurse navigator. that's helping guide you through the complex medical system to make sure that you're receiving all of the care and support you need. You'll be working with physical therapists, potentially occupational therapists, dietitians, and palliative care specialists. I think there's a slide or two dedicated to palliative care at the end of the presentation, which we will discuss. So like I said, the medical system can be complicated, and you were meeting a lot of doctors in a short amount of time. So it is very important that you have a physician that respects you and listens to you. As a patient or as a patient's family member, you will have a lot of questions, and you need to make sure that your team has ample time to answer all of your questions and to provide you with emotional support. Something that we don't talk about too often would be getting a second opinion. At least from my standpoint, doctors do this a lot. So if you have an unusual presentation of a cancer, or if you have cancer that's not responded to therapy, doctors will very, very, very quickly talk to their colleagues and even reach out to specialists in other healthcare systems, whether it's SSM, Mercy, BJC. But as a patient, a second opinion is also your right. And certainly, if this is a new diagnosis and you are scared, or if you have any concerns or questions, asking to see another doctor, another specialist, is not a wrong thing to do. And certainly, your physician will have no problem with it. At the very least, that might give you peace of mind that, hey, you know, the treatment algorithm that my doctor has created is the right treatment algorithm for me, and multiple specialists believe this is the best plan of action. Since you are going to so many appointments and you're starting new treatments and having more side effects, it's very important to communicate with your healthcare team. Any new medications that you start, they need to know about. Any questions you have, whether it's something you read online, something a family member has asked you, or just questions about the cancer or the treatment in itself, please ask these questions before your appointment. Write them down. Oftentimes we'll have patients with an entire page of questions, and that's okay. That's the best way to remember questions that you have about yourself and about your cancer. I always recommend that family bring, or that patients bring family, whether it's a spouse, or oftentimes children are very involved in care. This is important. They can write notes during appointments. They can help you address all the questions. And then any test results that you're concerned about, especially if you're seeking a second opinion, certainly ask us if we can get you copies. And if we can't get you copies directly, we can certainly direct you to medical records where they can give you all of the test results or images that you need. So treatment options. Next slide. So treatment options vary drastically, depend on the type of the cancer, whether it's non-small cell cancer or small cell lung cancer, and it depends on the stage. If you have a very, very small, you know, 1/2 inch cancer in your lungs and you're healthy, oftentimes all you need is surgery and we've cured you of your cancer. Certainly we will watch you closely, repeat CT scans, but that may be all you need. People with larger cancers or cancers that spread to other organs, the treatment may vary drastically. Treatment also varies based upon the general health of the patient. You know, some patients are healthy enough to undergo resection of an entire lung, some are not. And then certainly the patient's own goals are very important. You know, treating cancer in a 97-year-old woman with dementia is much different than treating cancer in a 60-year-old healthy person that's continuing to work full time. Usually the treatment algorithm or the treatment plan will be decided after a live discussion with the patient, as well as all of the doctors involved in the care. We've already briefly touched on this, but certainly you'll have many questions with a new diagnosis of cancer. A lot of the best questions I think are here on this page. Certainly, which treatment do you recommend and why? And not only which treatment do you recommend, but what other options are out there? And why did you choose this treatment and not the other options? Side effects are very important. I always tell my patients all medications have side effects, whether it's an ibuprofen or a Tylenol or chemotherapy, they all have side effects. And it's good to know what they are That way, if you experience a new symptom, you might know why you have it. And then you can tell your doctor that, hey, the side effect you informed me about, I'm having it. What should I do? How do I know my treatment is working? Very good question. Certainly, sometimes chemotherapy can make you feel a little bit sick. You might have some nausea and vomiting, but it may be treating the cancer. So we don't always only look at the patient, but we might repeat a CT scan or another form of imaging to decide if the treatment's working. And then clinical trials. So I think every healthcare system in Missouri is involved in clinical trials, but this is very important. It may not be important, you know, at the very, very beginning of treatment, but certainly if you're not responding to treatment, or if, you know, you've developed side effects in the standard treatment, clinical trials are always an option, and we'll touch on that a little bit more later.
Dr. Munzer, if you don't mind, I'd like to jump in quickly.
Of course.
At Cancer Support Community, we do have a program called Open to Options. You can call and ask for an appointment with one of our clinicians who will sit down with you and help you organize a specific question list for your own situation. So if you are newly diagnosed and you are trying to figure out what might be best for you, or maybe you're thinking about finding a clinical trial or whatever the, you know, big decision is, we can help by sitting down with you for as long as it takes, and understanding more about your situation, asking you what your goals are and who is in your network. And then we can help you write down very specific questions that you can take with you to your appointment, or give to your medical team, so you feel a little bit more prepared.
All right, thank you, Danny. I did not know you guys offered that, and that is a phenomenal service. So thank you for the input. Okay, so now let's briefly kind of touch on treatment options. As I said, treatment really does depend primarily on the stage of your cancer. So when we talk about cancer stages, it's usually stage 1 through stage 4. Stage 1 being the most treatable, usually smaller cancer that hasn't spread. And stage 4 is the lung cancer that has spread to other organs and oftentimes is very difficult to treat. And, you know, possibly, you know, we can treat it, but may not be able to cure it. When we talk about staging a cancer, just briefly for your education, we use the TNM staging system. T really refers to the size of the tumor. So as the tumor gets bigger, the stage gets higher. N refers to, has it spread to lymph nodes? As the cancer spreads, it sometimes spreads to the bloodstream. It can spread through the lymph nodes. So as it starts invading more lymph nodes, that increases the stage of the cancer. And then M stands for metastasis. So certainly if it spreads to another lung or another organ like the brain or the liver or the bone, that also increases the stage of the cancer. When we're talking about non-small cell lung cancer, the main options we have would be systemic chemotherapy, which includes chemotherapy, targeted therapy, and immunotherapy. We also have radiation and therapy and surgery. If you have a new diagnosis of cancer, you may be a candidate for one, if not a combination of all three of these treatment modalities. We will first talk about surgery. So surgery, this is where the thoracic surgeon steps in. They're the experts in cutting out parts of the lung. Surgery is often used for earlier stage cancers. So if we think by cutting out a bulk or all of the tumor that we could potentially cure the patient, this is when we're talking about surgery. Typically with stage 1 and stage 2 lung cancer, and sometimes stage 3, especially if the patient is deemed to be fit enough to tolerate surgery. And this is really up to, you know, the patient's symptoms. How fit are they? How far can they walk before they have symptoms? And if we do a special lung test called the pulmonary function test, how strong are their lungs? Depending on where the tumor is or the stage of the tumor, we may be talking about a pneumonectomy, and that's removing an entire lung. So certainly that can be a big deal. We may be talking about a lobectomy, or removing a lobe of the lung. In general, the right lung has 3 lobes and the left lung has 2. Or we might even talk about a smaller surgery known as a wedge or a segmental resection. and folks that may not tolerate taking out a lobe or the entire lung that have a small tumor, sometimes we consider a wedge resection. Radiation therapy, this is when we use high energy rays to kill cancer cells. Historically, just like with all these treatment modalities, we weren't necessarily experts in how it worked and how to do it. So if we gave somebody radiation, we would hurt not just the cancer cells, but a lot of the good cells, either within the lung or the surrounding organs like the heart or the esophagus. With our newer therapies, the radiation oncologists are very, very good at trying to target most, if not all, of the radiation rays to the cancer cells. So certainly, you know, people might develop some symptoms like some inflammation of their lungs, but radiation therapy is now much safer, recommended for almost all patients if it's going to be beneficial, with much less side effect profile than we previously saw. Radiation therapy might be given alone. That might be all you need, especially if you have an early stage lung cancer and we don't think surgery is a good option, or it might be given with chemotherapy or with another type of therapy. And then chemotherapy. So chemotherapy in general is giving drugs, whether through an IV or oral pills, that damage cancer cells. Traditional chemotherapy does damage rapidly dividing cancer cells, but it also damages our own cells. And again, chemotherapy can be given alone or in with radiation therapy or with surgery. In addition to chemotherapy, in the last 10 or 15 years, we have newer targeted therapies. So you have the traditional chemotherapy that hurts the cancer cells and it hurts our own bodies. And then you also have targeted therapy and immunotherapy. And what this is we've realized that a lot of these cancers develop very specific receptors or biomarkers that are unique to that cancer. These biomarkers sometimes allow the cancer cells to grow quickly or spread more quickly. But the good news is sometimes we can use these specific receptors against the cancer, and we can find a very specific type of chemotherapy that will kill all of the cancer cells that express this receptor, but not hurt our own cells. That is called targeted therapy. And oftentimes people can have very dramatic improvements in tumor burden with a minimal side effect profile. More recently, we've also had immunotherapy. And that's what they're talking about at the bottom when they mention PD-L1. So we've known for many years now that our own immune systems, they don't just fight viruses and bacteria, they also fight cancer. And oftentimes cancer can be pretty smart and they can kind of mute our immune system sometimes. So our immune system doesn't recognize cancer as cancer. So what immunotherapy does is it really revs up our immune system so our body can say, hey, there's cancer in the body and we're going to take it out. And that is what immunotherapy is. And again, some patients are candidates for immunotherapy, and it can be a more targeted therapy that may have a better side effect profile than traditional chemotherapy. All patients should be tested for biomarkers. And as a patient, this is not something that you typically have to worry about. Certainly advocate for yourself. But anytime a doctor takes a biopsy, whether it's with a bronchoscopy, that's the procedure I do where I go in through the mouth into the lungs, or with an IR percutaneous biopsy, that is almost automatically sent out for special stains to look for those special mutations or to see if you're a candidate for immunotherapy. So definitely, you know, all patients diagnosed with cancer, especially if it's advanced disease, should be tested for all these biomarkers. If the cancer has recurred after it initially got better, they should be tested. And more recently, we're even testing people with small cell lung cancer for PD-L1 to see if they're a candidate for immunotherapy and chemotherapy. As I said, we usually do these tests based upon the tissue, based upon the biopsies. However, sometimes we can do liquid biopsies or blood testing as well. This is something that the oncologists would know much more than I would about exactly which mutations and biomarkers can we test with liquid biopsies versus tissue biopsies. But in general, your healthcare team will make sure that we do as many tests on the biopsy, the tissue biopsy as we can. All right, and as I mentioned, biomarker testing is very important because these newer treatments, whether it's targeted therapy or immunotherapy, they oftentimes, if the patient's a good candidate, work better than traditional chemotherapy and often with less side effects. And then certainly with every year, we find more and more mutations, more and more biomarkers. So certainly even these newer biomarkers, if we don't have a standard treatment for this new biomarker, the patient may be eligible for a clinical trial to address this specific biomarker. We already talked about the goal of targeted therapies and I think immunotherapies on the next page. Small cell lung cancer treatment is a bit different. As I mentioned, it likes to spread more quickly. And it divides very, very rapidly. So with exceptions, surgery is not used as often to treat small cell lung cancer as it's used to treat non-small cell lung cancer. Typically, if you have a diagnosis of small cell lung cancer, we're talking about either chemotherapy or a combination of chemotherapy and radiation. So with small cell lung cancer, we still use the same TNM staging system, stage one, stage two, stage three, or stage four, but we also subdivide it in limited stage or extensive stage. And basically what this means is limited stage means that the entire cancer that we can see can be captured in one radiation field. For instance, if you have small cell lung cancer in your left lung and it's spread to the lymph nodes, but it hasn't spread outside the left lung, you would have limited stage and you might be a candidate for chemotherapy and radiation therapy to that left lung. If the cancer has spread to your bones or to the brain or to other organs, then we call it extensive stage. And we're usually primarily talking about systemic chemotherapy, unless sometimes we do use radiation therapy for palliation. So for instance, if the cancer has spread to the bone and it's causing a lot of pain, sometimes we can give radiation therapy for that reason. We often also give it, or we can give it on the brain if we're concerned about cancer developing there. All right, so other types of therapies that we can use, both for small cell lung cancer and non-small cell lung cancer, they mention here laser therapy. And certainly sometimes people have cancer or tumors within their airways, so within your main air tubes, whether it's the windpipe, the trachea, or the major mainstem bronchi, sometimes the cancer can block those off. And if the cancer blocks those big airways off, patients will have a lot of symptoms, a lot of shortness of breath, they may be coughing up blood. Sometimes we can direct specific types of lasers or argon plasma lasers to the tumor to try to break it open so we can open up that lung. Clinical trials. We've mentioned this a few times now, but clinical trials are great. We advanced medicine through randomized clinical trials. It is important to know that if you're involved in a clinical trial, it's not like you're a guinea pig. The way clinical trials work, especially with cancer, is we compare a new treatment to the standard of care. So typically, you know, let's say the standard of care is two specific chemotherapy medications. The trial might involve those two medications plus an additional new medication to see if it has a survival benefit. So if you're involved in a clinical trial, it's not like we're going to give you placebo all the way. You will still receive some aspect of standard care. It's just going to be against something new. With a clinical trial, the patient often does not know exactly which treatment arm they're in, whether it's the standard care arm or the new treatment arm, at least when they're involved in the trial. Clinical trials can be quite burdensome. I definitely recommend them. I'm not saying I don't recommend them, but usually it involves a lot of follow-up, a lot of phone calls, a lot of appointments. But this is how we advance care. And we've had, you know, I've had patients enrolled in clinical trials and they've done great. And certainly if you are in a clinical trial, you can back out at any time. Just because you sign up, it doesn't mean you're stuck in the trial until it ends. If you decide this is not for me, you can always back out. This is just a little bit more about clinical trials. Certainly the doctors that are running the trials will talk to you about all of the safety aspects, and they'll make sure that, you know, they get consent from you and or your family to make sure you're agreeable to being involved in the trial. Usually a lot of the costs are covered, but it is good to ask, you know, do I have to pay for this trial or any medications or side effects or anything like that? So side effects. So we touched on this earlier, but patients with cancer often develop a lot of side effects. You know, a lot of those side effects can be because of the cancer. If the cancer is in the airway, you can be short of breath. You might cough up blood. If it's spread to your bones, you might have a lot of pain. And it's not just the cancer that causes the problem. It's often the treatments we use to cure the cancer or to treat the cancer. So that may also cause fatigue, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, loss of appetite, sores in the mouth. Some types of chemotherapy can cause a neuropathy or some tingling or loss of sensation in your fingers and toes. Certainly, chemotherapy can also lower your blood counts. If your red blood cells go too low, you may need a transfusion or you may just feel more fatigued. When your white blood cell counts go low, it will make you more susceptible to infection. Chemotherapy can also cause changes in your hair, skin changes, reproductive changes. And certainly between the chemotherapy and having cancer, anxiety and depression are very prevalent. They can be treated, they can be addressed. So, you know, if your doctor forgets to discuss, you know, your mental health with you, certainly bring that up at the appointment, ask if there's anything they can do or any recommendations they have, especially if you're having symptoms. As I mentioned, any and all side effects, discuss with your healthcare team. At least the oncologists, the cancer doctors I've worked with, they've all been phenomenal. They do a great job managing the side effects, both from the cancer and from the treatments that we often give to treat the cancer. So certainly any side effects, even if you're not sure if it's related to the cancer or not, let them know. Let your family know, you know, write it down, bring it to the appointment and see what we can do to help. All right, and then palliative care. This is something that I just think in general is very, very unutilized or underutilized. So most people, when they hear palliative care, they think hospice. And certainly, you know, at the end of life, palliative care sometimes can transition into more of a hospice approach. But palliative care should be involved early on, in my opinion. So we have many studies now that show that the earlier you involve palliative care, especially if you have advanced cancer, those patients do better. So palliative care really focuses on the well-being of the entire overall patient. You know, they focus on how you're feeling about cancer. They focus on your symptoms. Sometimes they're better than me and your oncologist at focusing on symptoms. They discuss with your family, is there anything they can do to make, you know, this treatment better for you, or, you know, your appointments easier to get to, transportation. So certainly, if you have any questions about palliative care, bring it up with your oncologist. Involving these folks early on is a great thing. And again, we have multiple studies, especially in people with lung cancer. If we involve them early on, people tolerate the treatment better and they often live longer. All right, and I think, Danny, this is where you take over.
Yes, thank you. So we know that there are several universal challenges of living with cancer, and that can be a loss of hope, feeling a loss of control, learning how to live with that uncertainty of the diagnosis, and unwanted aloneness. And there are specific challenges of living with a lung cancer diagnosis. Oftentimes, there is an associated blame, even if lung cancer has been diagnosed to non-smokers. So regardless of the smoking status, you know, it's important that everybody deserves compassion and the best available treatment. Distress, Dr. Munzer already touched on this a little bit, but distress is one of the most common side effects of cancer. And it can impact your cognitive, behavioral, social, emotional, and spiritual functioning. So it's important that you talk to your doctor, your nurse navigator, ask what resources are available, and pay attention to how severe and chronic your symptoms are. Everybody is going to have some level of depression or anxiety, but when it becomes problematic or life-altering, it's important to bring these things up to your medical team. So that can be a loss of pleasure in your activities, sleep disturbances, a loss of appetite, fatigue, restlessness, and especially any kind of suicidal thoughts. It's also important to remember that being positive or optimistic or hopeful doesn't mean that you don't feel those negative emotions. It's okay to feel that full spectrum of emotion. And it's also important to develop realistic expectations about your illness. Focus on making decisions about your care and your life, while also maintaining hope and reasons to be optimistic. Still making future plans, still connecting with family and friends, and doing things that bring joy into your life. Expressing emotions can have a great impact on your physical and mental health. When you express your emotions, you are more confident. You are able to control your emotions. You're able to find support, empathy, interest, and humor in life. And repressing emotions can lead to increase in irritability, aggressiveness, hostility, as well as isolation and alienation. At Cancer Support Community, we offer support groups for people who are living with cancer. We have support groups for family members or caregivers who have a loved one with cancer. We also have support groups for people who are finished with active treatment and are trying to figure out their new normal, what comes after cancer, or maybe they're living with cancer as a long-term health condition. So we have support groups where you can meet other people in the same situation as yourself and release some negative emotions and find these opportunities for support. We also have a monthly drop-in networking group for people specifically diagnosed with lung cancer. So reaching out for help. It's important to talk to your friends and family, find a support group like the ones we offer at Cancer Support Community. You can utilize online resources. Cancer Support Community has a national headquarters as well as a local office with online resources. You can talk with other professionals such as clergy or other mental health professionals, and also try mind-body programs for stress management and relief. Cancer Support Community offers a variety of stress management programs, including one, a monthly offering called Stress Less, where you can learn different techniques to process your anxiety or your distress, such as guided imagery, breath work, progressive muscle relaxation, and other mindfulness activities. And just generally find ways to take care of yourself. Learn about nutrition, try to make better eating choices. Cancer Support Community offers education about nutrition and cooking demonstrations on a monthly basis. try doing some daily exercise, yoga, tai chi, qigong. These are things that are very gentle on your body, but help you move your body as well. Even slow walking is helpful. Make sure you're getting enough sleep. Engage in social activities, find social support, make sure you maintain your hobbies, make sure that you're able to connect with others and engage in a spiritual practice. And here are some additional cancer resources. These will be made available to you after this session. I'm going to go ahead and stop sharing now. Let's see. Do you want to go ahead and stop recording?
Yeah, we can stop recording.
Also, I wanted to let you know that there is a book